he's about to make the anode. So how many did John get last week? Not many people here. A lot more. Is this... He stood so right here and... Now look, I'm not lecturing next week. You all switched off. And that's all that's left. So the pitch that he winds this with... Oh, this is the cathode, isn't it? Sorry, I haven't been paying attention. So... The current passes through there and electrons leave the surface and get sucked towards the anode where the electric field has developed. We'll give it 5 more minutes. And this is some spot welder. So he's just welded those 2 bits together with an enormous current. Just in case you missed it, this guy is making a fermionic valve. Bits of glass up to get the last little bits of oxygen stuck out of the surface. finish it some other time. But now you've no idea about this crazy French video I was just showing. Never mind. I thought it was funny. That's the important thing. So you will remember 118 quite keenly. Yeah, there were 6 questions on the exam, and 3 of them were mine. And nobody liked question 3 because it had a horrible transistor in it. Yeah? Question 1 on diodes, question 6 on op-amp, question 3 on transistor. And we all avoid question 3 because we don't like the second part, because it's complicated. How you will rue the day you didn't bother with the transistor. And you'll rue that day now. In this lecture, I will give you the aims and objectives of this part of the course, and some books that you ought to consider maybe getting if things get a bit sticky. And then I'm going to go back over some stuff from 118, which I think everybody needs to hear a handful of times before it really goes in. And that will be output characteristics, transfer characteristics, and small signal model and transistor. And then I want to go back to some of the one transistor circuits, amplifier circuits, that we were looking at in 118, and consider some more general concepts that are to do with one transistor circuits. And the reason for that is that later on, even tomorrow and thereafter, we'll be looking at how op-amps are designed, and they are composed of many, many transistors. And we'll need to be reasonably familiar with how a single transistor acts on its own before we can worry about what happens when we put them together. So it's quite important that we go back and have a little look at some things that we've probably seen before. So my aim for this part of the course is to continue our description of the operation of analog circuits. So it's pretty vague. That's to say, I want to give you a toolkit, or carry on giving you some tools, which will allow you to analyse any circuit you might come up against. So the examples that I'm giving, while they are specific, are general in the sense that they are there to demonstrate certain techniques, and the techniques are applicable in all cases as long as you apply the right assumptions. And it's the assumptions bit that usually catches people out. So there are probably 14 to 16 lectures, and approximately a third of them will cover, or will deal with, an introduction to some common analog building blocks. So that's operational amplifiers in this, for the majority of that. Then I'm going to talk a bit. Yeah, okay. Dying. If you die now, you don't have to take the exam. It's pretty good. So we'll spend 4 or 5 lectures looking at the frequency dependence of operational amplifiers. Up till now, it's always been operational amplifier is perfect, works very well at DC, probably works very well at light frequencies as well. Obviously not true. There is some limit, and we need to be able to say what that is, sort of in a quantified way. And then I'm going to spend 3 or 4 lectures talking about electronic noise in circuits. Why is it you can't measure the exact position of a single atom, and how does this relate to how current flows through devices, that sort of thing. So this is different from the other parts of EEE225. Neil's talking about digital circuits. So when I say multi-transistor circuit, I'm thinking 4 or 5. When he says multi-transistor circuit, he's thinking 2030, probably. Although it's what, 7 for a NAND gate, I would imagine? Depends what technology you put it in. My good friend John, I'll edit that, don't worry, is talking about semiconductors some more. And in fact, the bit that he's teaching is much easier than the bit of 118 that Prof Houston taught, because now it's all about how devices work, not what happens to the electrons and holes. So you don't have to worry about scattering mechanisms or that sort of thing. It's just a case of learn the drawing of a MOSFET. I guarantee, having not written the exam and having nothing to do with his car, it'll almost certainly come up. I bet money on it. So for my part, I want to broaden our understanding of how to make electronic devices work in circuits, especially integrated circuits, because the majority of the you go out to be analog designers, which will be like two or three tops. The rest of you will end up doing something else. Most of you probably not even end up in engineering. Some in finance if you've got a brain. No soul. Most of the time you're not dealing with discrete circuits. You'll be dealing with a team of 50 or 60 other people designing a massive IC, and you'll have one tiny little bit of it which is yours, and they'll scribe your name on it in tiny little letters with a laser that you need an electron microscope to read, and you'll run around telling people years after, my name's on that. Where? Oh, it's inside. Yeah, it's about there. And they'll look at you like you're nuts. Very much like you're looking at me now. So, you can expect the usual from me. Some slides. I'll give you handouts. The handouts and the slides are available on the website. And the links in the slides, which are on the website, you can click them. There will be the videos available online when I've had a chance to edit them. I like to give out biscuits, if you are friendly towards me. And there will be problem sheets and problem classes, and the problem class is on Thursday from 1 till 2. So I'll probably turn up eating a sandwich. There's the library. And if you need help, you can email me outside that time. I'm saying at the bottom, I'm going to assume you're familiar with 117, 118, and 156. I will not always assume that, but everything that's in here builds on what's in there. So if you need to have a quick look again, you can go and watch the videos and get the notes and so on and so forth from the teaching resources. So we have some books, and the books are the same books from last time, so I'm not going to make you spend any more money. The Art of Electronics is on the left, Sidra and Smith in the middle, and Milman and Gravels on the right. I'm a big fan of Milman. He's been dead all my life, and probably some before that as well, but he wrote brilliant textbooks, in my view. The Art of Electronics is a book which is full of words. It likes to describe circuits and not really do maths. And if you need the concepts written in words, it's quite good. But the words can only take you so far, and the book is relatively limited by that. Sedra and Smith's, can't ever remember actually opening a copy in anger, because it was written after I'd done my learning bit. But other people say it's a very good book, so. Microelectronics by Milman and Gravel, I bet you could pick it up on £8 for a couple of quid. Delivery will probably be more than the cost of the book. So, into the meat of it. You'll remember from 118 that there are two junctions in a transistor, and that depending on whether those junctions are forward biased or reverse biased, will determine what mode of operation it's in. And if the base emitter junction is forward biased and the collector base junction is forward biased, the transistor will be switched on, or it will be in saturation, and it will be like a switch that is switched on. And if we have both the junctions turned off, the transistor will be switched off and it will look open circuit. But if we have the base emitter junction forward biased and the collector base junction reverse biased, it will behave like an amplifier. And conversely, if we put it in backwards, reverse bias the base emitter and forward bias the collector base, it will behave like an amplifier, but quite a bad one. And that's because the modern transistors are not made of three bits sandwiched together, all being equal in width and doping density. The emitter and the base are doped in a particular way, and the collector is doped somewhat differently, and the widths are a bit different as well, because it optimizes the forward active region at the expense of the reverse active region. But since we don't want to use the reverse active region, it doesn't matter. So we won't be heading towards the top left of this graph ever. So the forward active region provides amplification. So the two transistor amplifier circuits, which contain one transistor each, that I talked about in 118, were both forward active region for the transistor that was in them. And that provided voltage and current gain for those circuits. Not all transistor configurations will provide both. I think I've said everything on that slide already, actually. Essentially, it's the description of the regions previously. Anybody want to hear it again? Right up. The only other thing to say is that sometimes you'll see a transistor like ZTX653, for example, and it will say medium power NPN switching transistor. And the reason is they do something to the base that means you can extract the carriers, the minority carriers in the base, really quickly, which means you can turn the device off faster than you would otherwise. And in the sort of 70s, early 80s, they were doing a lot of experiments with doping the base with gold because it allowed recombination much more quickly. So when they say switching transistor, they're doing little tricks like that to allow you to turn it on and off faster. On the other hand, if you bought, 2N3904, it will say low power NPN small signal amplifier or something like that. That does not have such trickery involved. It's just meant to be a little amplifier circuit, or make a little amplifier circuit. So in 118, I think it was lecture 10 or 11, I spent a lot of time talking about the characteristics of transistors and showing some graphs that were collectively called the characteristics, and this was one of them. And it shows the collector to emitter voltage against the collector current for a set of base emitter voltages or base currents. Your choice. The graph looks the same either way. And the business here, this bit where all the lines are, is a saturated region. And everything to the right of about there, the line is actually slightly curved. I suppose you can draw it as a straight line. It's slightly curved. But it curves up and all the stuff over here is forward active region. So to turn on the collector base junction, if I've got to turn on the collector base junction, why is this so small? The 0.7 is there, which is what you want to turn on a transistor with. So how comes this is all the way down here? What's going on? That would be, yes, possibly. But that isn't really what I'm looking for. But you can have a biscuit anyway. Think about what the axis is showing. With one slight adjustment, you're right. Go again. Yeah. So? You're making it so complicated for yourself. This is VC, let me get a bit of chalk. And you can have this, yeah? You see it right there, yeah? So I've got a transistor look like this. And this is giving me 0.7. And I'm saying that if I were to, so I've got secretly a little diode in there, and secretly a little diode in there. And the only thing that makes the transistor not two diodes is that if we look at the structure, the transistor is not made like this, but we'll just say that it is for now. I can make it NPN if I wanted to. And this will be the emitter, and this will be the base, and this will be the collector. So it's as that is. The only thing that makes this not two diodes, NP and PN, is that I can suck carriers out of this region and through the base without them recombining and make them flow in the circuit in the collector. And depending on how many minority carriers I inject in here, depends what ratio will get through. They're not tunneling, they do pass through this region, and some of them do recombine, and the ones that recombine are what makes the base current flow. If this region was really big, and all the carriers that left here recombined here, no current flow there, and I would have two diodes on one piece of semiconductor, and they would just be two diodes. Nothing fancy. So I'm trying to get VCE there, and I've got a voltage here and a voltage there. And if I'm looking at this one, well, that one and that one subtract from each other to make that one, because they're facing against each other. So if this is 0.7 and this is, say, 0.65, that could be 0.05, right? Which is why this is not, in fact, 0.7. So it was a circuits question, sorry. I steal those back from you. I would never ask a semiconductor question, that would be so unfair. There are other people that do that. So if we're making our amplifier, we would probably want to put some resistor between VCE and the voltage source called VCE and the transistor. And that resistor would form a line on this diagram. And we said before there'd be an operating point, and that the operating point would move according to how we dealt with VBE. I don't want to get too much into that right now. If you need to see it again, it's all in the videos from 118. The other characteristic that I'd spent some time talking about was the transfer characteristic. And this is the relationship between IC and VBE. This data is simulated from I can't remember which transistor. 2M5555, I think. So it's realistic-ish, as realistic as a decent simulator will give you anyway. And we have it here for a range of VCE, so that the different colored lines are different VCEs. So VCE has a slight impact. And the reason it has a slight impact is, what happens? Go back now, it's a semiconductor question. If I put a big voltage between here and here to make this much higher than that, what will happen to this diode? It will be more than it was before. And what does that mean in terms of electric field? It's stronger. And what does that mean in terms of this, the distance? So I've got some electric field. Larger depletion region. That's four or five biscuits there. So if this is this is electric field, magnitude on, and this is distance down the device, I could start off with a small depletion, bigger depletion, bigger depletion. The more I deplete the base, the easier it is for electrons to get over, because they've got to get through less stuff without recombining. So the gain essentially goes up, which is what we're seeing in that diagram. Or rather, the collector current for a given VBE goes up. Gain is a bit shadier. If you feel a bit sad about characteristics, now is the time to address it. Horowitz and Hill's pretty good for it, because he gives a nice arm-waving description. Or that they give a nice arm-waving description. And once I was done with characteristics, I spent quite a lot of time dealing with small signal models. And what we said was, or what I said, what we agreed was that if I took some VBE point, say 0.7 or 0.72 or something like that, I would get a certain collector current. And if I then only made a slight change in this value, a small sine wave on top, this dot would move down and up ever so slightly. And as long as I didn't move it too far, I could assume over a small range this line is straight. That's what makes the small signal model a small signal. And the signal wouldn't be small if it was sufficiently large that this line had to be curvy to be physically sort of realistic. So if my line came all the way down here and there was a big difference, that wouldn't be good enough. then I'd need a different kind of model. And if you say, well, I'm going to assume the slope of the line is constant and is fixed at where the dot is, I can differentiate the curve and get the gradient at the operating point. And if I do that, I'll get one number that describes the slope of the curve, which obviously is fictitious because more than one number is needed to describe the slope of the curve. But that's why the model only applies in the small region, because there are limits or boundaries. So I do the differentiation, and we end up with GM, the mutual conductance, which is DIC by DVBE, is EIC upon KT. And I said something like, commit this to memory forever or something. Or it's QIC, Q and E interchangeable, both electron charge. And this is really what makes transistor action happen, because GM is constant over many, many, many orders of collector current. In fact, if you go in Horace and Hill, there's a nice little graph from about 0.1 picoamps up to about 100 amps, where it's just a lovely straight line on log scales. If you were to look at beta, for example, current gain in common emitter mode, it changes very much with IC and lots of other parameters. And yes, you can use it to do the working out, but it's not a fundamental driver for how a transistor works. And also, it only applies to bipolar transistors, whereas GM applies to valve, MOSFETs, JFETs, bipolar transistor, everything. You can even apply it to a traveling wave device. And I spend a little bit of time with some diagrams like this one, saying, oh, well, I could make my transistor into a two-port network. Although I might not have actually used the word two-port network. But anyway, that's what this is a kind of. And we've got an input and an output, and I said something along the lines of, well, the transistor's only got three terminals, I've got four terminals, gonna have to join two of them together. And it transpires that we join this one and that one, and they become the emitter. And then we arrive at the small signal model for the transistor. And in the simplest case, we will say that the resistance RC is infinite. And the making that resistor infinite, what we're really saying is that on this graph, all these lines are parallel to the x-axis. That little slopey bit is caused, or not caused by, the fact that there is a slope is dealt with in the model by adding that resistor between the collector and the emitter. And if you were to take a ruler, or a bag of spaghetti maybe, and lay some spaghetti on each line, and you had really long spaghetti, somewhere over here, all the lines would meet and cross the x-axis. And that voltage would be the early voltage. That might come up in a lab sometime. Nugget of wisdom for you. So we're assuming they're parallel, those lines, when we say that the resistor is infinite. When we say that the base emitter resistance is infinite, that's not so easy to do. That would make the model extremely simple and difficult to deal with. For JFETs and MOSFETs, it's pretty much true. For bipolar transistors, we have to do a bit more digging to actually get a model that's physically usable. And we say that RB is DVBE by DIB. So VBE by IB is not a graph that I've shown, but it is in 118. And what we're really saying is, it's the characteristic of the base emitter junction, in the same way that I showed that several other characteristics. You'd get a diode type equation. And if we took the gradient of that, we'd get a small resistance which represented the relative change of IB with VBE. That's what that resistor's doing. It also turns out that RB is approximately beta upon GM. The derivation is there. I don't want to just stand and read the equations to you, because you'd be much better off going through it yourself, because there's nothing worse than reading stuff for it to not really work out. You need to try it. And if we multiply RBE's beta upon GM and VB upon IB through, you end up with GM VB is equal to beta IB. This one's actually reasonably important because this equation's existence is the reason why you can choose to think about the bipolar transistor as either a thing that accepts a current and gives you a bigger current out, or a thing that accepts a voltage and gives you a current out. And it's your choice. But beta is just a number which exists because of the existence of RBE, and beta is not something that really makes the transistor work. It's the mutual conductance, the transconductance that describes it. Nevertheless, there are occasions when, if you look at the circuit, you'll go, I want to sum the currents at this node. It would be much easier if I could just do it all with currents. And then you can go, well, I'll use beta. And there'll be other occasions with the circuit, which is slightly different in topology, where you'll go, it'll be much easier to add up the voltages around this loop and do loop analysis instead. And you go, I'll use the GM and VBE. And you can sometimes get one or two less equations in your analysis by choosing carefully how you want to think about the transistor. I still have trouble picking the right one. Yes. The only other thing I've missed is to say that only bipolar transistors have an RBE which is finite. All the others you can just assume is infinite. When I say all the others, I mean MOSFETs, JFETs, valves, so on and so forth. So we as... If you don't like my reasoning for RBE's existence because of the characteristic, there's some current that goes in here, which is the minority carriers here recombining with the... majority carriers here recombining with the... Minority electrons here recombine with poles doing that. That's what causes the base current to flow. The fact that you've impressed the voltage there means you've got a V and an I, and if you divide one by the other, you get a resistance. That's another way of thinking about why RBE exists. No grid current in a MOSFET. Infinite. I can't even think of the word to describe it because you never use it. Right. Happy? Let's talk about some amplifiers. This is new material now. Well, this is newish material now. We have two common emitter amplifiers, and they are somewhat simplified from EEE118. And the thing that's changed is I haven't bothered with a resistor between the base and the ground, and I haven't bothered with a resistor between VS and the base. And those resistors are there to bias the transistor into conduction. I'm just assuming they're all wrapped up in RS. So what I'm really saying is, my actual circuit looks like this. Oops. I'll draw the NPM one. Sorry. What I'm doing is I'm saying, well, if I was a signal here, yes, we're back to that again, signals and jam jars. If I was a signal there, my options for getting to ground are in the base, down there, down this resistor, up that resistor, round there, through the power supply, in the ground, or back through the source. So if I was this signal, these are my options. What I'm doing is I'm wrapping up this lot and just calling it, so I'll call this R source, And if I take all these three together and appropriately combine them, I'll call that RS.
You don't have to worry about what the appropriate combination is. It just simplifies the circuit diagrams. That's all. If you don't like that, you can ignore it. That's the good thing about it. So, both types of common emitter amplifier are possible. We can use NPN or PNP transistor. In the diagram, I've flipped the transistor into a PNP and I've flipped the power supplies. Depending on what textbooks you're looking at, sometimes they will draw the PNP version the other way up and keep VS plus at the top because they think that looks nicer or it doesn't make the head hurt quite as much. In other books, they will put VS minus at the top and have it like that, and sometimes they put VS minus at the top and have the emitter up the page. And that was what was done in very early textbooks with transistors for archaic reasons. So when you're looking at them, be a bit careful about what you're actually looking at. I'll be sticking to this style though. Both of these transistors have the same small signal circuit, and if we had the same quiescent collector current, they'd have exactly the same small signal circuit, same numbers. Obviously, if we change the quiescent conditions, we'll change the value of GM, because GM is EIC, big IC being a quiescent thing upon KT. I'm also saying that RL is the total load resistance. So we have, in the same way that I've got this trickery, if we have an amplifier circuit, we're going to have some, ignore the rest, have some load resistor, and then we have to have some signal coming out here. And this will be a quiescent voltage, VC, called Q, plus or minus delta VC, which is going to be a little wibble on top. So if I drew a graph, it'll look something like this. This could be VC here. And maybe it looks like that. Most of the time, I don't want this quiescent, the DC part. I just want to take the signal. So Charles Dar, I pop a capacitor in there to get rid of the DC and just leave the AC. And then I'm going to do something else with this signal. So there'll be another thing here, which I don't know what it is. Could be another transistor circuit, could be the input to an operational amplifier. Transmission line, anything. And it will have some internal resistance, probably to ground. And what I'm saying is I'm ignoring this because I'm going to make sure at the frequency I want to run at, this looks like it's short circuit. I'll make it big enough. I don't know how big it is, but I'll just make sure it's big enough. And then I'm going to take these two and lump them together. And the reason I can do that is the same as I did over there. There's a battery here biasing this transistor to provide the power supply. And if I'm a signal here, my options are out the circuit and into the input impedance of the next circuit. Or I call that little R here, if you like. Or up through RL, down through the power supply, into the ground that way. This one connected together. So I'm not worried about all this stuff. I'm just assuming that the thing I call RL in diagrams is containing a function of the input resistance of the next stage. And the reason I've done it is to make the diagram simple. Because I want. Talk about RCE briefly. In the small signal model, RCE would be between there and there. So the signal could jump through RCE and go in the ground that way. But don't worry about it. Enough to know that it's there, that's all.
Did I miss one? No, I didn't. So this is my small signal model for the amplifier on the last slide. And if I was to sum up the currents at the output, that's to say where it says IO on the right in the diagram, I'd have VOUT is equal to IOUT times RL, and IOUT must be equal to GNVVE because there's only one loop and it's got a current source in it. So the current that's flowing in that loop must be the value of the current source. No other current can exist. That's how I get 13. I'd minus because IOUT flows down through RL, but GNVVE must flow up through RL, so I've got a sign error in there. And if I did the same at the input, I'd have VBE is IB upon RBE, and that's VS potentially divided between RS and VBE. So 14 is the potential divider expression, essentially. And if I substitute 14 into 13, I'll get 15, and then, well, I won't. I'll get something that leads to 15, and I just solve it to get VR over VS, which is the gain for the circuit. I've got an output voltage, an input voltage, divide one by the other, gives me a ratio of the voltages. That's the voltage gain. Happy with the concept of voltage gain? Yes? Good. So the first thing we can say is, well, the gain is inverting. I've got a minus sign. And then we can say the gain is proportional to GM. So large GMs are attractive. So a bigger GM is better, generally speaking. Bigger GM has lots of other implications that I don't want to get into right now, but they will come along eventually. But broadly speaking, bigger GM, bigger gain. Similarly, RL being bigger is attractive because GM multiplied by RL is a function, is the large part of the gain. And if we can make RBE much bigger than RS, we can avoid attenuation at the input. So what I'm saying there is, let's say VS is a volt, and RS is a mega ohm, and RBE is a kilo ohm. So there's a ratio of 1,000 between them. What will my voltage across RBE be? 1/1000th approximately of VS, which is quite small. So I've got a volt, I've thrown away 999 millivolts, and I'm going to amplify the 1 millivolt that's left. If I amplify it by 10, my overall gain is 0.01. You follow my logic, or is that a bit too much? Happy. You don't look very happy. In fact, you look good. No, you don't look miserable. There aren't too many hangovers in the room today, which is good. Early in the semester, let's get it out of the way first. So we want to make RBS nice and small, but we might not have control over RBS. RBS, we haven't got any control over them. God, I'm going to get sued, I have to edit that out. We haven't got any control over RS, probably. So we are in control of RBE. Because we can choose a transistor with a big beta and we can control GM. So it's our job to make sure that RBE is big enough that it's much, much bigger than RS. And if we do that, we'll have minimal attenuation at the input, and this will allow us to get a nice big gain because the fraction RBE upon RS plus RBE will be quite large. The only other thing to say is the resistance looking into the input. So if I was a signal at the right-hand end of RS, thinking about getting to ground, because that's all signals think about, my options are back through RS or down through RBE. And if I take away the source and I'm the signal just sat on the top of RBE and I want to get to ground, my only option is straight through RBE into the ground. So if I'm thinking about the resistance looking in there, if I was that signal, the resistance that I see to me getting to ground is just RBE. Nothing else to it. Happy with that? Just imagine you're the signal. So what happens if we degenerate the emitter?
If you look at the 118 nodes, this is very nearly the circuit of the type 1 circuit, except I had a couple of resistors to bias it, and I've already said that they've disappeared for the reasons that I gave over there. So we're now looking essentially at the same circuit that was in the 118 course, without the collector to base feedback. Sometimes the common emitters that see in circuits have a small value, which is a few tens to a few kilo-ohms in the emitter. And usually we call it the emitter degeneration resistance. It's a kind of negative feedback. Feedback is really cool. If you did the amplifier lab last week, you'll obviously agree with me. Or maybe you're still recovering, I'm not sure. Feedback can do all sorts of wonderful things to your circuits. You can make the sensitivity of the circuit's operation to component values smaller, so you can use cheaper components with bigger tolerances. It can reduce the distortion in your nonlinear circuits. All amplifiers are secretly nonlinear. Just we call them linear when we do the small signal model, because we made the line of IC and VBE straight for that one point. That's the linearization of the circuit. It can increase your output resistance, it can decrease your output resistance, increase your input resistance, or decrease your input resistance, depending on what you want and how you configure it. In this particular situation, it has some good things. We would never use feedback to do bad things because we're not evil. No, because that would be pointless. You wouldn't want the feedback to act against your circuit design. So this is emitter degeneration. And we just add RE into the small signal equivalent circuit in the appropriate place. And it does complicate the small signal model quite a lot, especially if we include RE. The main reason it complicates the small signal model is now we've got this RE in the emitter. We've got the base current contribution flowing in RE, and we've got the collector current contribution flowing in RE. So we've got some coupling between the input and the output now, which is how the feedback works. It sends part of the output back towards the input to do some good things. But this actually makes the maths a bit more troublesome. So our small signal equivalent circuit looks like this. So we've just added RE and shuffled everything else up. VS and RL still connected to ground. And the approach is the same. We sum up the currents at the emitter. Everybody happy with the idea of summing currents? When I'm summing the currents, what I'm saying is that I'm going to add up IB and IE and GMVBE, and I'm going to make it so that they all equal zero, assuming I use the arrows. Well, IB plus GMVB equals IE, because IE is leaving the emitter node and the other two are entering the emitter node. And I can't have any current made on that node or destroyed because that would require me to be able to produce energy at will. And while I am immensely powerful, I am not yet that powerful. So IE is IB plus GMVB. And if you wanted to, you could write beta IB here instead and just keep going. The analysis would look slightly different, but you get the right answer in the end, assuming you didn't make any mistakes. And we can say that, well, IE is V upon RE, because I just applied Ohm's law to IE. And that's equal to VB upon RBE, which is applying Ohm's law to IB, plus GMVBE. That's a current, and we can't apply Ohm's law to the current source. We just have to leave that as a current. Something else we can say is that if we shuffle around 17, we can get 18, which is V is VBE times RE, brackets 1 upon RB plus GM, those brackets. And I can say, well, that's approximately equal to VBRE times GM. And the reason I can do that is because 1 upon RB is equal to GM upon beta. You can derive that from the equation that I gave somewhat earlier, where I said VBGM is beta IB. You can get it out of that. And if I say, well, beta's much, much bigger than 1, that will give me a relationship between GM and RB that is quite favourable, and it means I can take certain bits of 18 proper away and leave myself with the approximation. Would be quite a good idea to sit down and, when you write out the approximation that I give, start working out what terms you can cross out and figure out how I got to the approximate form. It's not going to be examined. None of this is examined. It's all build up to tomorrow, pretty much. But the doing the maths is one thing. Actually thinking about what approximation you can make is quite important, because when the circuits are enormous, unless you have very, very wide paper, it's difficult to write the equations out because they get huge. And figuring out what's important and what's not is the skill of the engineer. Doing the big equations is the skill of the applied mathematician. So I've got myself an equation 18, and that's in the looking at the currents at the emitter. If I now add up the current, the voltages in the input loop, I can say Vs plus the voltage across Rs, which is IB times Rs, because only IB can flow in. If you imagine that it disappears, I've just got Vs, Rs, RB and RE. That's a loop. And in that loop, all the currents, all the voltages have to sum up to zero. So I'm doing a little loop analysis on that loop. Vs is IB, Rs plus VBE plus VE. And I know that IB is VBE upon RBE. So I can use IB is VBE upon RBE and equation 18, the full version.
Full version?
No. Approximate version. To yield 20. Which is VS is VB, blah 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 blah, all the stuff that's written there. So my next job is to get rid of VBE. Because I just want V out over V in. So VB has to go away. So if I look at the collector circuit, I can have a V out is I out times RL. That's the same as in the non-degenerated version. And I out is minus GM VBE, also same as in the non-degenerated version. And if I use the equation 20 from the last slide, along with those two new bits of information, I get 21. Because I've got an expression for VBE. And then if I just solve 21 for V out over Vs, which is the gain, voltage gain of the circuit, I'll end up with 22. And then I can use a sleight of hand, which is R little e is 1 upon GM. I don't want to prove it now because it's a little bit involved, but if you don't want to take my word for it, try a textbook. If you prefer, you can use the equation above and not simplify. That's okay. So we got minus RL upon RE plus RS over beta plus RE. So what can we say about this other than I made a nice equation? We know the gain is inverting because there's a minus sign. We know that the gain is still proportional to RL. We know that RE reduces the gain because it's on the bottom. In the denominator, not on the bottom. Slid into GCSE maths mode for a minute. And if RE is much, much bigger than RE, if R, big R, big E, is much, much bigger than little r, little e, and big R, big E is much, much bigger than RS upon beta, then the gain is just given by RL upon RE. So what I'm saying is, assuming certain assumptions, the gain boils down to RL upon RE. Nothing to do with the transistor, any old transistor you like. As long as you don't break your assumptions when you pick your resistor values, you cannot worry about what the transistor's up to, and your amplifier will have a gain just determined by the two resistors, which is really handy because we've got drawers full of resistors with the numbers on. So you can just do something simple to figure out what gain you want. As it happens, the addition of RE also affects the input resistance of the amplifier. And I'm not going to do it now, because I'll do it later. In fact, probably tomorrow, that will come up again for a slightly different circuit, which yields the same result. So, I did my usual first lecture bit where I said what you'd get. And then we did some bit about operation of transistors. And then I talked about forward active region, reverse active region, all that sort of thing. And then I went over some graphs that we've seen before, which describe the transistor's operation in terms of the voltage and currents. And then I spent a bit of time going back over small signal models and how we can use a linear approximation of the transistor at a single operating point to derive some linear expressions. We didn't use any exponentials today. That's really what that means. And I talked a fair old while about common emitter amplifier. Tomorrow I'm going to, once I've written the lecture, talk about common collector amplifier, common base amplifier. Then we're going to go and have a little think about op-amps. And then towards the end of tomorrow's lecture, we will look at the inside of an op-amp. And it's about 7 or 8 transistors. And then we'll spend the next couple of lectures picking our way through what all those transistors do, how they interact, and how we make an analog building block, which is the operational amplifier.
There he is.